Kia ora tātou everyone. Welcome to the third of our food and beverage opportunity seminars in East Asia. Today we've got a look at the Philippines and Vietnam. And these two are these markets are the growth engines of Southeast Asia, where the strongest growth is. But to tell you all about that in a lot more detail, oh, and by the way, I'm Viv Williams. I'm the program leader from the East Asia Food Program. The East Asia Food Program is a whole raft of activities that we've got running out of NZTE to help F&B exporters into East Asia. So, and with me, I've got Hernando Bernal, he's the TC in the Philippines, and Tony Martin, TC in Vietnam. And I'll let them both introduce themselves to give you a bit of background on who they are.
Yeah, hi, mabuhay. This is Hernando Bernal, Trade Commissioner to the Philippines. I have lived in New Zealand for 15 years, studied, work and live there, particularly in Auckland, West Auckland and East Auckland. I have done international trading for 7 years in China and Hong Kong, wherein I covered 26 countries in 5 continents, supplying industrial equipment to the steel industry. Before I joined NZTE, I set up my own BPO company here in Manila and also set up a trading company, supplying again, servicing the steel manufacturing sector here in the Philippines and the neighboring countries. I've been a trade commissioner for 4 years and I'm looking forward to our presentation today on F&B. Tony?
Kia ora everyone, Sintiao. I'm Tony Martin, based in Ho Chi Minh City, here in Vietnam. I've been up in market here for around 2 years. Prior to that time, I spent about 6 years in total working for Fonterra, based in New Zealand, in both domestic and international facing roles. Also spent some time working for DB Breweries back in New Zealand. So most of my career has been focused on sales, marketing, and operational type positions. So really enjoying working up here in Vietnam. It's a fascinating market, and we've got some great work that's happening across our region in East Asia, particularly focused on food and beverage. So really looking forward to sharing some of that with you today and answering your questions as you have them. Thank you.
Okay, so the format for today is we'll go through a macro summary of these two markets as a whole, and then we'll have a look at the Philippines, and I encourage you to ask questions at the end of that presentation. You can do that through the instant messaging, which you'll find at the bottom left-hand corner of your screen. You'll see there's something that looks a little bit like a cartoon call-out. If you can't type into that straight away, you can just click on it, and that should open up a little screen where you can type your messages. So send those through to Hernando and Tony at any time, and they'll answer them at the end of their presentations. And then at the very end, we'll wrap up with any questions and answers as well. Just to look by way of introduction, the guys are presenting information from this report. We had commissioned through Frost and Sullivan, just looking at all the export opportunities. So this was just done in May, and quite interesting insights. But they'll also be adding, our trade commissioners will also be adding a lot of their own commentary on the market reality. So we've got good balance of theory and practical. If you need any help after this or questions, you can go to the website, check if you're export ready. If you're an NZTE customer, definitely go and talk to your customer manager. Or if you're new to NZTE, we'd be more than happy to help you out. Just give our customer service team a call on that number there. Without any further ado, I'm going to hand over to our trade commissioners to start on the Philippines and Vietnam.
Well, thanks, Viv. Next slide, please. Right, the macro and demographic overview for Vietnam and the Philippines. As Viv said on the title page, that we're the emerging markets, the fast emerging markets of the region. The Philippines and Vietnam has enjoyed a tremendous GDP growth in the last 4 or 5 years. In fact, Vietnam is predicted to be the best performing economy this year in East Asia in terms of GDP growth. However, please be aware that we're coming up from a low base GDP. So it could be a bit misleading sometimes, but the thing is that the GDP growth for the last 5 years has been exceptional, so 6.5 to 7.5% for the Philippines. We might have the one of the lowest nominal GDP size in East Asia. However, there is a massive disparity in the distribution of wealth. Which created elite communities in our markets with immense purchasing power. There's also another thing that's unique for Vietnam and the Philippines. We have a very young population. The median age of the Philippines is 23 years old. Vietnam is 30 years old. This equates to a younger working population with purchasing power. So you have to consider that when you're doing your marketing or you're developing your designing your products. We also have a reasonably large population, 100 million for the Philippines and more than 92 million for Vietnam. And this is also the next item is expanding urbanization, which is becoming very common in most of the regions, in most of the countries in our region. For the Philippines, about half of the population lives in urban areas. And it's one third of the Vietnam population that lives in the urban areas. Next, please. I just want to quickly show you this analysis from Frost and Sullivan regarding the brightest prospects in terms of domestic F&B consumption. As you can see, Japan is definitely the largest domestic consumption in volume and in amount in value. However, as shaded in this oval light blue shade, countries like Indonesia, Vietnam, Thailand, and the Philippines are the countries to look out for in terms of growth in F&B consumption. Next, please. Over to you, Tony.
So just to finalize some of the key points from a macro perspective, it's interesting to note that across this part of the world, the likes of Singapore and Hong Kong, for example, tend to import around 98-99% of their F&B requirements based on their inability to produce agricultural products within their own countries. And generally, the developed markets have a really high import dependence. But for Philippines and Vietnam, as emerging markets, they both already import more than 70% of their F&B requirements. It changes a little bit by subsector. For example, dairy in both our countries, we have a really high reliance on imported product. Fruit and vegetables, on the other hand, is a slightly lower proportion. But when we think about the products that we export out of New Zealand, we can see that the import requirements for both of these countries is just going to continue to grow as the population continues to expand and their protein intake also increases at the same time. So in terms of the food market share, Philippines and Vietnam have similar levels of meat consumption. So around 14 to 15% of consumed food products is meat-centered. But the Philippines has a much higher reliance on processed food in terms of the dietary requirements, whereas Vietnam's cuisine and local dietary requirements are still really heavily weighted on fruit and vegetable focused meals and overall consumption at around 46%. Thinking about the channel splits in our country, so Vietnam is a stronger food service market. There's still a lot of traditional style eating out on streets and so on, whereas 80% of the food consumed in the Philippines is purchased through the retail channel. So slightly different channel split between our two countries. And then when we think about the type of purchase environment in retail, Both countries still have a really heavy focus on the traditional style wet markets or mom and pop stores, and we'll find out a little bit more about that as we dive into each of the markets. So that concludes just a really top line summary of what's happening in Philippines and Vietnam. So I'll pass back to Hernando, who will take you into Philippines now.
Right, thanks, Tony. Well, welcome to the Philippines. Back, please. First slide. Yeah, welcome to the Philippines. I titled my presentation Your Gateway to Asia, and I'm going to be telling you the reasons why I thought that's an appropriate title. If you look at the map on the right, the Philippines is strategically located within less than 4 hour flights from the major cities in East Asia, from Tokyo, Seoul, Beijing, Shanghai, Taipei, Hong Kong, Macau, Singapore, Jakarta, KL, Vietnam. So it is all within less than 4 hours flight. Next, please. Now, just quick facts about the Philippines. The population is 100 million. That's easy to remember, but it's increasing every year, the rate of 2.5%. So we have 2.5 million babies born every year. Median age is 23 years old. That means, half of the population is 23 years old and younger. Land area is almost as big as New Zealand, but we have 7,100 islands, so you can actually consider the challenges on the logistics in terms of covering the whole country. Religion, 90% Christian. We're the only Christian-dominated country in Asia, as published, and we only have a 5% Muslim population. They are mainly concentrated in the south, which is Mindanao. Now, the main commercial centers, we have three main commercial centers in our three regions, Manila, Cebu, and Davao. Manila being the center of commerce, and it's actually the capital and the political capital as well, with 14 million people. About at least 80% of F&B products, imported F&B products, they enter through the Manila ports. And one thing that sometimes people are not aware of, the official language here is English. Next, please. Now, just some macroeconomic demographic overview of the Philippines. I just would like to show you, a couple of points here. The agriculture sector is small, aside from the banana and the pineapple industry, which are well established. Most of the subsectors of agriculture are inefficient and not really, they're not really as productive as those of the developed countries like New Zealand. However, 90% of the GDP relies on services and industry. For the industry, our main export is actually semiconductors or electronics. This has been true for the last three decades, but it's declining. There's like a decline on this merchandise export of electronics. But the growth sector now that's driving the Philippine economy is services, and I'm going to be covering that on the next slides. Next, please. Now, this is something that is also unique about the Philippines. Overseas Filipino workers, we have more than 10 million of them out there, and they are religiously sending remittances every month to their families here in the Philippines. If you can see the massive growth there, like from 2011, we crossed the 20 billion US dollar barrier, and we added another 7 billion in just 4 years. So the 2014 figure is 27 billion of annual total remittances from our overseas Filipino workers. The good thing, the unique thing about this is that most of this money goes to domestic consumption, and majority of that goes to the food that is served on the table of families. So it's a big chunk of that is spent on F&B. Next, please. Another subsector in our services sector is the business process outsourcing. This is another phenomena which only started what 15 years ago from almost nothing. From 15 years ago, it now grew to 1.2 million direct employment. And these are mostly young people with the, you know, good paying jobs, you know, relatively, and the and generating export revenue of $18 billion. This was last year's statistics. Now, the unique thing about these two subsectors, why I highlighted them, is that they seem to be independent or resistant to global financial crisis. Historical data actually show that every time there is a GFC, the remittances goes up, and the business process outsourcing business also grows. So they're actually like an antidote to GFC. So this is the reason why the Philippine economy has been stable and shielded from many external situations. Next, please. Now, I'm going to be talking here about the mega trends. The mega trends are actually very, very common to the region, globalization. Perhaps what's unique about the Philippines is that we're very friendly on Western culture. We've been colonized by the Spaniards for 300 years, and then after that, the Americans took over for a while, and then until we got our independence after the Second World War. We are one of the largest F&B markets of the U.S. The Filipinos are already aware, and they are adapted to the Western brands and the Western taste, particularly from the United States. Urbanization, as you can see, we have growing cities. The Gen Y generation, these are the millennials. We have a lot of them, and many of them are earning good money. So they're quite a good segment of the market to target on. Another sector that is growing here as well is the health and wellness sector of the F&B. Next, please. Now, just to break down on the food and beverage sector, so what Tony mentioned before, that the processed food is still dominates the breakdown for the F&B sector. One thing that I would like to point out on this slide here is the steady growth of F&B consumption in the country. As you can see, that it's growing at a rate of 7.63 compounded annual growth rate. That's about, you know, from 2010 to 2014, in the span of 4 years, it grew by 50%. So it's an emerging market for F&B. If you can see the dip on the F&B consumption, which is the yellow line, that was 2003 and 2014. We had the major disasters at that time. So there was an incident or something that is an exception. We had the Typhoon Haiyan at the end of 2013. Next, please. Now, the key segments for the processed food is led by dairy, bakery, oil and fats, sweet and savory snacks, and canned preserved food. Next, please. And the key segment for the beverage are the soft drinks or the carbonates, and then the coffee is number two. There's one thing that's unique about the coffee market in the Philippines. Even though it's reasonably mature market, there's still a this is actually majority of the coffee sales in the Philippines are in the instant coffee and a 3-in-1 coffee. So the premium brands are still there's still lack of availability of the premium range of coffee and also the healthy brands of coffee. So there's still opportunities there. Next, please. Now, another important thing if you're an F&B exporter to the Philippines is to be very well aware of the regulatory requirements. There are a lot of information in this slide. I can let you read it during your own time, at your own leisure. But the thing that you should be aware of is product registration process in the Philippines can take a long time. When I say long time, it will be between 6 months to 1 year, and sometimes it can take up to 18 months or longer, it depends. But it won't be a 2 month or a 3 month process. And you have to be, also be aware that there are instances wherein the Bureau or the FDA or even the Department of Agriculture might execute an administrative order that can be a showstopper for your products. So you have to be aware of those nuances. Next, please. Now, in terms of the competitors, the key players in the processed food markets, if you look at the list there, you will have the usual global players like Nestle, Unilever, Royal Friesland, Mead Johnson. However, the rest of those companies on the list are homegrown local companies such as San Miguel, JG Summit, CDO, International Oil Factory, Century Canning. With this local homegrown food processor like JG Summit, they're expanding internationally overseas. If you're aware that JG Summit just recently acquired Griffins in New Zealand, so they are. This is a growing sector here. Next, please. Now, just to show you a very simple common supply chain model for New Zealand F&B products that are arriving in the Philippines. This is a very basic schematic, but one thing that I would like to highlight here is that for a New Zealand F&B exporter, your usual touch point are very limited. It's usually the importer distributor or the local food manufacturer. It's very, very seldom wherein a hypermarket or a chain of convenience store or hotels will deal directly with the New Zealand exporter. These are only in certain special cases. So your main interface to the market will be your importer, distributor, or your local food manufacturer. Next, please. I just would like to highlight that we had the FDA, which is the ANSFATA. It was implemented in 2010. At this point, we have 89.7% of our tariff line duty-free. And it's been one of the most utilized FTA in the Philippines, so we're doing all right with our benefiting from this free trade agreement. Next, please. Now, these are photos of our traditional and the new and modern retail landscape. Although 70%, according to studies, still 70% of the population still goes to the traditional wet market and the mom and pop stores. There is now a high growth, an incredible growth in the expansions of modern supermarkets around the country. The leading brand of the supermarket chain is SM Supermarket. They have, this is just one of the dominant brand. They have 39 Super Value Store, 89 Save More supermarkets, and 42 hypermarkets around the country. A good example of how the expansion rate is going, there is a company called Double Dragon Properties. And this year, they are developing 29 mini malls around the country simultaneously. And they are now targeting the tier two and tier three cities and municipalities. So this is the trend of the future. The modern retail shops, supermarkets, and hypermarkets. There are also a big expansion in terms of convenience stores, like the 7-Eleven, Mini-Stop, Family Mart, Alpha Mart. So this is again another big growth in the retail landscape. Next, please. Now, health and wellness wave in the Philippines. People are now, particularly the middle class, are now getting aware of the health benefits of healthy foods, and there are now the like in some supermarkets there are dedicated aisle for the healthy product lines. One particular beneficiary of this wave is perhaps I think a good example is Zespri. They've been branding the kiwi fruit as healthy, more vitamins than an apple or an orange, which is actually taken off. So this is another sector that is growing and that you might want to consider. And people are willing to pay premium to actually get into this wave. Next, please. Another sector that has changed its configuration recently in the market is the food service sector. There are now five distinct classification of food service establishment. One that is growing rapidly are the quick serve restaurants. Well, the leader here is Jollibee, leading the fast food chain with a network of 750 stores nationwide. Well, if you know, Jollibee has competed head-on with McDonald's and beat McDonald's hands down in this market. Another growth subsector here are the casual dining restaurants. These are mainly the foreign franchise or foreign restaurant chains. And we also have we're seeing a lot of growth in the coffee shops. These are the Starbucks and the Shell's Best, but a new subsector are the specialty coffee shops, which are the third wave coffee gaining ground. And then we also have the something to cater the high-end patrons and the expats. These are the fine dining new luxury restaurants. And another growth area that is expanding fast are the hotels, resorts, and casinos. In the last 2 years, we have 15 newly built five-star hotels and four major casino complex only just in Manila. So this is a growth area. Next, please. Now, just before I end my presentation, food for thought. When before you consider the Philippines as your gateway to East Asia. Well, it's English. It is English here. Commercial and legal documents, meetings are in English. Product labels are in English. You don't need to have a separate product label. New Zealand products here, they still contain the same English labels when they hit the supermarket shelves. No need for translators. And halal certification is nice to have, but it's not critical. You can still hit majority of the population without halal certification. Urbanization, well, Metro Manila is the most priced and most logical target. I mean, if Metro Manila's got a 14 million people residing on it, and another 6 million comes to Metro Manila to work during the day. So you have more or less around 20 million market here, consumers here in Manila. There is now a need for premiumization. These are the main reasons why local companies like JG Summit acquiring Griffins, because they needed they need to complement their brands with premium snacks in the supermarket shelves. There is also, of course, similar to most of the region, growing affluent upper and middle class. Now, Western culture. The Filipinos were known to some as the brown Americans, or sometimes we are referred to as the Asian Latinos. So we're very welcoming to Western culture. We're probably the most Western friendly culture in Asia, but that's just my own opinion. Now, local partner, you have to have a great partner. I mean, this is probably the most important aspect of your business entry into the Philippines. Your local partner should have solid industry contacts, experience in handling logistics. A challenge here will be cold chain facilities for the perishable items. And your local partner should be well aware of all the regulatory nuances. Now, the last thing that you need, that I want you to take away is the regulatory regime. I mean, as long as you're aware of the nuances or the delays or the complications of doing product registrations or getting import licenses, I mean, you should factor that into your strategy and into your plans. So a well-knowledgeable local partner is absolutely critical to overcome those challenges in the regulatory regime. Well, I now end my presentation. So I'll be willing to answer any questions from you.
I see, Hernando, there's one there asking who owns the registration? Is it the New Zealand company or the importer?
Well, the registration is owned by the importer. So the importer has to have a certain registration, like a license to operate, and it has to be depending on the product, it has to be a licensed importer as well to get the product registration. Like a product registered by an importer is different from the same product to be imported by another importer, if you can follow. I mean, for example, if I'm importer A and I registered a Whittaker particular brand and size of a Whittaker chocolate, that's my registration for the Whittaker chocolate. If I'm importer B, I have to apply for a separate FDA or product registration certificate for the same product. So it's owned by the importer.
Hernando, thanks very much for that. And audience, if you've got any questions for Hernando that you're still typing, he can answer those at the end of the presentation. We'll move along to Tony. Yeah, thanks, Hernando. And we'll move along to Tony.
Okay, yeah, so we'll fly a couple of hours across from Manila over to Ho Chi Minh City. Now, so we are neighbours, and we're separated by a very hotly disputed stretch of water. But Vietnam and Philippines, as we mentioned right at the start, do share quite a lot of similarities in terms of our stage of development. Although I'd have to say, Philippines, in the most part for food and beverage, is probably a year or two ahead of Vietnam at the moment, and that's purely based on the history that Hernando has talked through, as well as some of the investment that's happened in the Philippines. Nonetheless, Vietnam is a very rapidly growing market, and for New Zealand exports into Southeast Asia, last year we had around $550 million of exports from New Zealand to Vietnam. So it's our smallest export market in Southeast Asia, but it's the fastest growing. And 60% of our exports are food and beverage related. So huge opportunity and potential across a number of subsectors in food and beverage. So we'll talk about that shortly. On to the next slide. Thanks, Viv. So just a few fast facts around Vietnam. So population of around 92 million. So we have 1 million new babies born in Vietnam every year. The average age is a bit higher than Philippines. So currently sits just over 30. And the geography is dominated by the two main cities, Hanoi and Ho Chi Minh City, both with a population of over 8 million each. And then we go down to the tier two cities, Da Nang, Khun Tu, and Haiphong. They all have a population of over 1 million. But the really interesting thing about Vietnam's demography is the fact that 2 out of every 3 people still live in a very rural and basic subsistence style environment. So we still see a lot of farmers with 2 or 3 cows and a pig and a few chickens, just living to feed themselves and their close family. So it's a long stretch from that style of living into the fast pace, rapidly growing environment that we see here in Ho Chi Minh City. Hanoi is also growing quite rapidly in terms of its urbanization, a lot of new infrastructure and buildings, a lot of foreign investment from Japan, Korea, Singapore, Taiwan. These countries really see Vietnam as a strategic position for putting their money in this part of the world, and that's really helping to move Vietnam along at a fast pace. When we look at the size of the target audience for premium quality food and beverage products, the types of products that we export out of New Zealand, I think in all reality, the size of the consumer base in Vietnam at the moment is probably only around 5 to 6 million people in terms of who earns enough money to be able to purchase the types of products that we're selling. So out of the total population of 92 million, you're really breaking it down to 5 or 6 million, which puts us on level pegging with Singapore, for example, at the moment in terms of the size of the market. But the key factor really is the rate of growth and how rapidly people are moving to the cities. Based on all this foreign investment, a lot of multinational companies are setting up production, manufacturing base here, corporate headquarters are moving into both Hanoi and Ho Chi Minh City. And of course, these people are earning much higher salaries and wages than they have in the past. And they're the people that New Zealand companies really need to start working on now in terms of growing our profile and our awareness of the quality of the types of products that we export. At this point in time, the main importing countries for food and beverage into Vietnam are China. So China, being the big northern neighbour for Vietnam, still sends a lot of fruit and vegetables south across the border. And I'll tell you a little bit more about that shortly. Because of the French connection here in Vietnam, 100 years of French occupation in Vietnam means that there's still a legacy of French influence in food and beverage. And we see that a lot with the bakery chains and a lot of French-inspired cuisine. The US has started to play quite heavily in Vietnam with food and beverage products. The other ASEAN nations, of course, with manufactured and processed goods are exporting into Vietnam. And then Australia has been very aggressive in trying to grow Vietnam as a key F&B market for them in this part of the world. So we see a lot of Australian beef, continued growth in Australian dairy products, and also in packaged consumer goods. So we don't want the Aussies to get too much of a march on us. We need to to make the most of the opportunity of this growth market now. Next slide, thanks, Viv. So just a snapshot of the trade and population summary for Vietnam. The population distribution chart there shows just how reliant Vietnam still is on the small towns and the rural villages, still making up a huge chunk of the population. But the key statistic here really is in the growth of the GDP per capita. So at the moment it sits just under $2,000 per person, and that's going to double over the space of the next 6 or 7 years. So this is all linked into this growing urbanisation and the move of people out of the rural centres into the big cities. So it's projected that Ho Chi Minh City, at the moment, the population ranges somewhere between 9 and 10 million, depending on where you stop counting. Predicting it's going to grow up to 15 million within the next 10 years. So these people moving out of the cities and in, moving out of the country and into the city are going to have more money to spend on the types of products that we're importing. Next, thanks. Just to give a very quick overview of the balance of product categories, food and beverage product categories between Vietnam's imports and what it exports out. You can see there's a really heavy reliance on milk and milk products coming into Vietnam from a number of countries. New Zealand is the key exporter of dairy products into Vietnam. Fishery products are also relevant to the types of companies that we have in New Zealand exporting to this part of the world. Animal vegetables, fats and oils, fruit and vegetables. So Vietnam over the last couple of years has seen really tremendous growth in the import of New Zealand fresh produce, particularly in apples and with kiwi fruit as well, and much more opportunity for growth in that subsector. In terms of Vietnam's export categories, they're the second largest coffee exporter in the world, and also the third largest rice exporter. So really heavily weighted on agricultural exports. But I have to say the quality of the exported product out of Vietnam still leaves a lot of room for growth and marketing potential. They're still very much at the early stages of developing a profile for Vietnamese exports. Next, thanks. I'm just going to pull one piece of information out of this slide, and that is the CAGR growth on the GDP per capita, which I just mentioned briefly before. So Vietnam's got the fastest growing GDP per capita growth rate in our region, projected to grow by over 10% in the next five years. And again, that really comes down to a change in the urban profile. So I think if we remember one thing about Vietnam from this presentation, it's following a trend that's similar to what has happened in China, with this really rapid urbanisation, and the countries or the companies that have invested early on in trying to grow a profile or a platform in certain sectors such as the food and beverage, reap the rewards longer term, to wait for that urbanisation to happen and try and grow your brand or your product in the market. The risk, I guess, is there the competition is going to be a lot hotter in 5 or 6 years' time. So we're really strongly suggesting that for companies that are interested in Vietnam, now is a ripe time to really understand the market before we get to that stage. Next, thanks, Viv. So if we look at the 10 trends leading to opportunities for high-value food and beverage products, high GDP growth, we have covered off a golden demography, so it's a very sizable and young population. The rising middle class, so we're seeing this greater disposable income come into play now. The urbanisation, which I've mentioned several times, is key to understanding this market. The consumer spending on F&B is growing, particularly based on imported products. Modern trade distribution. So Vietnam is very underdeveloped in terms of its modern trade retail network. But shortly we'll see where all that growth and investment is starting to come into play with multinational companies entering the market in retail. There's an increasing exposure to Western lifestyles, and a lot of that is based on the fact that a lot of Vietnamese students now are going offshore to study and then are coming back to Vietnam to take up jobs or build their businesses here. There's growing health consciousness, and food safety is critical to understanding the Vietnamese market. A lot of suspicion around imported product from China. There's a growing tourism sector, so even though Vietnam doesn't promote itself particularly well externally, the tourist domain here in terms of the resorts, the natural beauty of the landscape is a huge opportunity, and The HoReCa sector is growing to match the increase in tourism profile. And then the final one, Vietnamese preference for imported products over locally produced or certainly those that are imported from China. But it's not all roses. There's certainly a lot of barriers, and it's not an easy market. It's a difficult market to get into, and it's an even more difficult market to stay in. So the limited infrastructure and distribution for perishable foods is really a bit of a hamstring for Vietnam at the moment. And that's particularly related to any frozen or chilled products. The supply chain and the distribution infrastructure is still years away from getting up to the sort of situation we have in Malaysia or Thailand. We've talked about two-thirds of the population living in rural areas. So when you're distributing your product in Vietnam, how do you reach those, that mass of people? Is your product suitable for distribution in rural areas? For ambient product, of course, it makes sense, but then where is it going to be sold? There's a lot of mom and pop stores and wet markets that may not be suitable for some of the types of products we're exporting. And Vietnamese consumers are very price sensitive, and it's purely based on, the spending power of Vietnamese consumers for buying imported products. But secondly, it is a bartering culture, and the first price is not always the final price. So price sensitivity is key. There's still a lot of local F&B products in the marketplace, and as I mentioned earlier, more and more companies are setting up manufacturing plants in here to gain that competitive advantage based on the low cost of labour. So imported products carry a huge import premium. We have the ANZPTA free trade agreement in place here as well, which provides us with some great concessions on import duties. But Vietnam is very proactive in seeking FTAs with other countries as well. They've recently signed one with Korea, one with the EU. So that price competitiveness that we did have will diminish fast. So we need to think about how we compete with the local products. There are regulatory hassles. So thinking about product registration and testing, how do we get around that to make sure we're compliant in market? The traditional market versus modern trade, we've already talked about. Keep going, thanks, Viv. Yep, keep going. The cultural differences, so doing business in Vietnam is, again, quite different from doing business in Singapore or Malaysia. It takes time to build up relationships and to really cut through and understand how the market works. We see a lot of New Zealand companies who want to come into market and make a quick deal here, or they come here for a holiday and try and sell their product on the way out to the airport. It usually doesn't work. You've got to spend time understanding and developing relationships in the market. Skip through this slide, so just again a very top line overview of the distribution or supply chain. The key point to note here is the man on the motorcycle with all the boxes. So that is still the preferred mode of secondary distribution here in Vietnam. For those of you that have been here before, you'll know what it looks like. Anything and everything can be carried on a motorbike. But it raises a lot of questions around the integrity of chilled supply chain. For ambient products, no problem. It's actually a real convenience to have this type of distribution. It's fast and it can reach anywhere. But the investment in the cool chains is really still at a very basic stage here. Yep, next. So the key distribution channels in terms of retail, so modern trade, around 800 to 900 outlets across Vietnam at the moment, and we're starting to see some of the multinational players enter the market. The local government has made it very difficult for multinationals to come and set up here in the past, but they seem to be relaxing the requirements a little bit more now. So we're starting to see some of the players from the region enter, such as Dairy Farm with their giant stores, Lotte Mart from Korea and Aeon from Japan. But the general trade still so dominant, 9,000 wet markets and over a million family-owned stores here in Vietnam, very small scale. And that's where, you know, the majority of the product is still sold. But we think that the real opportunity for distribution and growth in Vietnam is going to come through e-commerce. And we think, based on what we can see, that there's going to be a similar trend to what we've seen happening in China, where e-commerce in some ways will jump over the growth of modern retail trade. Again, the men on the motorbikes is perfect for distribution reach here in Vietnam. So that's one to watch out for in terms of growth. In food service, still very much basic street food eating in many cases, but the investment in hotels and resorts, particularly along the coastline and in the big cities, is quite impressive. So the big multinational players are seeing Vietnam as a real strategic play for them in terms of their growth in the region. Okay, I'll leave this slide in for reference. Some of you may be interested to know what the landscape looks like for modern trade here in Vietnam. So I won't talk through it all, but if you are able to take a copy of this slide deck, some really useful information about the number of supermarkets that are here in Vietnam. The one that I've circled there is Vinmart. So they're a new player in the market. They currently have around 15 stores, and it's going to grow to 100 stores by the end of the year, and they've got a very, very aggressive investment strategy. So they will be the main dominant local player we expect within the next couple of years with modern supermarket type format across Vietnam. Okay, Viv. So I've just summarised up with our team here some of the key categories where we see the best prospects for New Zealand high-value products. And we're running out of time, so I won't talk through them all individually. But if we can look at the individual categories and see, where the immediate opportunities are, we think dairy for sure. Already Vietnam is importing 70% of its dairy requirements, and that will only continue to get stronger as the consumption levels rise. Seafood, Vietnamese are big consumers of seafood, and products like our green shell mussels are perfect for the type of market and food service environment that exists here in Vietnam. Fresh fruits, mentioned earlier, already a really big growing trend in the imports of New Zealand fresh product here into Vietnam, and we can only see that continuing on into the medium to long term. Meat. Vietnam produces a lot of its own pork and poultry, but is really reliant on importing beef. Lamb is a relatively unknown meat here for the typical consumer, but we think particularly in the high-end food service is a good opportunity for growth. And over to the next page. So, in terms of beverages, there's a small niche for New Zealand wine as it exists at the moment. We're one of the most premium priced wine importers in Vietnam and across this part of the world. But that's fine. We pick our niche and we play well to it. So we think that there's more growth opportunities in wine. Nutraceuticals, huge area for growth here based on the health conscious psyche of Vietnamese. So great opportunities for honey, for colostrum based products, and other health and nutraceutical type products. And in addition, we think in the medium to long term, the opportunities for packaged foods, consumer packaged foods, is where the Vietnamese consumers will go to, particularly with the introduction of e-commerce platforms and also with modern retail trade developing. Next one, Bob. So we'll skip over this slide and go straight to the summary, to the final slide. So the five key takeaways that we'll leave you with about Vietnam. Number one is around food safety, and the mistrust of product from China is really tangible. People here are really, really suspicious about imported food. And for that reason, the demand and the tendency for people to want to pay for product that comes from somewhere else that they know is safe, it's real. We can see it happen, and we've got some good examples of New Zealand products that are playing well to that story. Urbanisation, mentioned it several times, but that is the key point around Vietnam's population and where the growth is going to come from. The two main cities have got really rapid expansion happening now, and that's going to match up with demand for food and beverage products, as well as places to buy those products from. Channel choices, we think that the packaged food product categories have great growth potential here in the medium to long term, because people moving to the cities have less time to go to the wet markets and to buy food traditionally. So convenience type products will offer a great solution to that. And that's where e-commerce also comes into play for home delivery. Regional and global integration. So Vietnam is really on the cusp at the moment of moving from a very traditional type society into a much more Western style society, and that's what we're seeing in the big cities. I've mentioned earlier about the FDI growth. So if Japan, Korea, Taiwan, Singapore all see Vietnam as a really strategic market for investment, it must be saying something about where they can see some longer term returns in terms of Vietnamese population and its ability to be a powerful player in Southeast Asia. Vietnam stands to be a big winner from TPP once that's concluded, and that's based on the manufacturing advantages in this country. And so Vietnam, as part of moving from that traditional society to being much more Western, is heavily influenced by some of these outward investments and free trade agreements and so on that are taking place at the moment. And the last point there is around protein and health. So similar to Philippines, the health and well-being is a really important part of Vietnamese consumer considerations when they are thinking about diet, how and where they're eating. So that has a direct influence on the types of products we shall be importing from New Zealand into Vietnam. So that's it from me. Over to Viv to sum up.
Before we sum up, we've got a couple of questions here. The first one, Tony, just for you. Seafood companies, you talked about the opportunities there. How do they deal with those cold chain logistics that you're talking about?
Yeah, well, it's a good question. And we think of some horror stories of the man on the motorbike trying to deliver some frozen oysters to someone who's 40 minutes drive away, and get a little bit gun shy about whether or not, the seafood opportunities, whether or not it's the right time to do that. But in saying that, there are some good high quality importers and distributors. We say some local players and some international players who are the ones who are investing in, full cool chain and frozen chain facilities. So I think the opportunities at the moment are limited because the number of partners who've got the capability to do it is limited, but there is demand for it. So again, I think it's an investment play for seafood companies who can see a longer term win in Vietnam if you can connect up with the right partner here at the moment who is investing in capability, then I can see that, one, the quality of your and integrity of your product will be maintained, but secondly, you get a foothold in the market while all the investment is starting to happen in those cool chains for other parts of the country.
Thanks very much. I've got two questions now for both of you. So one of them is on the B2C e-commerce evolution in both your markets, and the other one's on asking if you can outline the opportunities in honey, so maybe you, in both countries as well, so maybe you can both have a go at e-commerce slash honey. Hernando, maybe start with you.
Yeah. Yeah, hi. The e-commerce industry here in the Philippines is still maybe 2 years behind what I saw in China. There's still a lot of not many people have access to bank accounts, so which equates to there's still a lot of opportunities for credit card companies to actually get everybody signed up. So in terms of B2C, I can, although in, on the other hand, I can see this growing rapidly in the next few years. But at this point, B2C for F&B is still an undeveloped market. It's still very, very early stages. But there are opportunities, but perhaps in the, not now, but perhaps in the next year or 2 years or 3 years. In terms of, shall I answer the honey question? In terms of, we have success stories with New Zealand honey products here, but the channels were not the traditional supermarket or retail channel. Honey is still a premium product, and it serves a niche market. So successful honey importers here are doing it in the non-traditional retail channel, like specialty stores or kiosk. It could be the health and wellness shops, or the high-end weekend markets. So that's still the current situation in terms of New Zealand honey here in the Philippines. But it's a growing market, but it's very niche. Thank you, Tony.
Okay, so for B2C e-commerce in Vietnam, so at the moment there are a number of regional players such as Lazada, Zalora, who are already operating here with some success. They're getting some good growth, starting off a very low base, but their product categories are still quite centered on clothing, apparel, electronics, not really a lot in food and beverage at this stage. There are two local players who are investing in developing their own marketplace platform similar to Tmall in China, where the focus will be on a number of categories but very heavily weighted on food and beverage and food and beverage distribution. So even though it's still in its early stages, I'd have to agree with Hernando that in Vietnam, the lack of access to bank accounts here and credit card ownership remains a little bit of a barrier to that growth. But the existing players, Lazada and Zalora, they still take about 80% cash on delivery for their product lines that they sell, and it works. It's still a cash society here in the most part, so I don't think it's going to choke the opportunity, but of course, again, similar to the Philippines, the banks are really courting this as a potential for them to, for a win-win situation, to get more people banking with them, but also to partner up with some of these players to encourage more online transactions or credit card transactions. So yeah, I think the B2C e-commerce is going to be, it's going to be a wave that we can't ignore right across Southeast Asia. Some markets are much more advanced than others naturally, but I think based on the scale of Vietnam and Philippines, we need to think about how we're going to build our strategy for F&B products to launch into that channel, because it's going to happen. On the honey, honey would be a perfect product to sell through that B2C e-commerce channel to start with. But again, similar to Philippines, the distribution network here for honey is quite heavily focused on health stores, health and wellness outlets, or pharmaceutical related outlets, as opposed to taking up space in more modern retail chains. And some of that is purely based on the fact that it is that high-end product. People specifically seek these types of stores because they buy honey as a health and wellness product, very different consumer behaviour to what we would have back in New Zealand or Australia. So at the moment, the number of those stores is still quite low, but again, there's a lot of investment happening in this space because of the consumer trends. I think longer term, you know, is New Zealand honey at the moment, the awareness is probably still relatively low. So the question we always ask is around, you know, what type of investment and marketing and support would our New Zealand companies put into growing the profile or awareness of their brand or New Zealand honey in general here in Vietnam? And that's where, you know, the work that NZT is doing in this high value food space at the moment, we're really interested in building that into part of what we do in promoting New Zealand here.
Thank you. So, well, thank you. It's all around, really. Thanks to our audience that are listening in today and taking the time to learn a little bit more about these two markets. They're both really fascinating markets in the East Asia area, and I can only underline what both Tony and Hernando have been saying about the massive growth opportunities. It's far outweighs anywhere else in the world the growth in these two countries. And also, thank you very much to Hernando and Tony for your time as well. It's been great to listen a bit more about what's happening in your markets in relation to food. And just everyone, after this webinar, we'll be sending out a copy of the presentation itself, so you can look through and maybe have a look at some of those photos, which are a bit small on the screen, but you can blow them up on your own computer. A lot of them are pretty interesting, actually. And also a copy of a recording of the webinar and links back to the Frost and Sullivan research as well. So that's us for today. Nō reira. Tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou, tēnā koutou katoa.